3 minutes past 7 a.m. 1380, the answer is the Phil Cowan program. Welcome, everybody, and a happy Tuesday morning to you. We have a guest joining us now. We just heard Devin Nunez in his opening remarks at today's House Intelligence Committee hearing, lambasting the press as nothing but a mouthpiece for the Democrat Party. There have been a lot of accusations about the press and their fairness or lack of same. We have an opportunity now to talk with a gentleman who is, in fact, a White House correspondent. Dr. Anthony Harper is the White House correspondent for Intermountain Christian News and the Christian Newspaper Association. He joins us now. Dr. Harper, thanks for being here.
Well, thank you for letting me join you, Phil. These are very hot issues that are going on, and I've been having a unique perspective in the White House press meetings and observation of other the press, and a lot of hostility there.
Boy, isn't there. I don't know when I've ever seen it like this. You know, it's interesting. We had, when his book came out, we had Sean Spicer here in town doing a live event with us last year, and I was... You know, I asked him about them giving press passes in the Trump administration and affording a little more prominence to some lesser news outlets in their press conferences. And I thought it was interesting that Spicer said, you know, the very first press conference I did, you know, all the big boys are sitting up front. He said, and the first question I took was from the back of the room from the New York Post. He said, because I wanted these people to understand that they don't control these press briefings anymore. These are ours. And we are going to dictate the terms of how this runs, when it begins, when it ends, everything. And I thought it was fascinating because I had no idea how these things operate. You also covered the last administration, Dr. Harper. How have things changed with the new administration, in your view?
Oh, well, a very significant difference. In the press room, very little hostility during the Obama press meetings in the James Brady press room compared to now, much hostility. And, well, we have in Obama's administration time, a lot of the press very supportive of President Obama. Rarely would I hear anything very critical, but we hear intense critical responses from the press. They seem to be all asking similar questions, almost like they are fixated on President Trump and can't accept him.
I one of the things that I was fascinated by in Spicer's retelling of how these press briefings had always gone is that all of the big boys in front, UPI and AP and the Alphabet Networks and everybody in the first row or two, they always got the first questions, and they sort of decided when things were over, they'd just kind of say, okay, I think we've got enough now, and they'd just sort of get up and leave, and it would be over with. Is that different now? Does the White House press spokesperson say when it's over?
Usually. I was there when Sean Spicer was there, and one day, you know, the press were getting out of control, and he said, that's it, and walked out. He called the shots and ended it. The press secretaries are in control of the direction of that. And, of course, as you know, and many, that we are not having daily James Brady press meetings anymore. And I see that clearly to the unethical behavior of a certain journalist. I had a conversation, Phil, with the White House Correspondent Association director, and asking him about if they had any intent to have any enforceable code of ethics, and he said no, and that it was the responsibility of the different news agencies. And so I can't see any daily press meetings resuming until after there is a code of ethics is enforceable by the White House Correspondent Association. And I want to get back to what you were talking about. There in the White House press room, the seating, specifically of the different news agencies, is determined by the White House Correspondent Association. And with no enforceable code of ethics, it's not playing out very well, and I don't see these resuming anytime soon. And the new press meeting forum seems to be more like what happens on the White House lawn. Some impromptu things, and it's really disturbing the hostility there.
I'm curious to know, as I said at the beginning of the show when I mentioned that you would be joining us today, I'm sure a lot of folks are probably not familiar with Intermountain Christian News or the Christian Newspaper Association. They might even be surprised that they have a correspondent with a White House press pass. I'm just intrigued, Dr. Harper, how are you treated by the other folks in the press contingent there?
Well, mostly I get along with the reporters there. There's a little discomfort at times because I'm asking questions that our readership would like for me to ask. We have a lot of Jewish and Christian people that are supportive of what I do there at the White House. But, you know, the questions regarding Israel, about religious freedoms, usually don't go over too well. There, but I have to report the truth nonetheless. And it's a very challenging time. And I think it's been a very unique opportunity for me getting called on in this current administration. As you mentioned, really it's a reference to the underdog or the press that doesn't usually get called on because they're not on the front row. I get called on the first week of the Trump administration. I'm sitting in the third row, sitting in someone else's seat that hadn't shown up, you know, getting this really hot question in and about a UN agency referred to as UNRWA that people may have heard about in the news. Ambassador Haley, President Trump defunded this UN agency as a result of asking this investigative journalism question, and it led to Senator James Risch of Idaho, who's now the chairman of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee, looking into the misuse of U.S. tax dollars and demanded a GAO to give an accounting, and there was a lot of corruption found in the misuse of our U.S. funds, but it is a very unique opportunity, you feel, to get called on now. More respect I see by this current administration of the Christian media.
Well, and that was going to be my next question. You said, you know, the questions you asked that are of interest to your readers, and if you're, you know, any kind of responsible journalist, those are the questions you should be asking. You know, the issues of religious liberty are pretty big right now in the courts and in the news. Does the rest of the press pool have no interest in those issues?
Doesn't seem that way, except for there are some other conservative sources there in the White House press room. But rarely do I see members of the Christian media, you know, being called on. And although there are more than there used to be, of course. I know President Trump appreciates the Christian media more, but we really don't have as many Christian media as people might think there. We're in the minority there. And so it's a great opportunity for me and some others. And I hope that the changes where we get have more access. I'm also doing something with working with Israel 24 News Television, and they're launching a new politics and religion program. Coming up, and I think one of the hottest formats, and this will be a podcast, but they've asked President Trump to do an interview with me, be shared with an Orthodox Jew, and addressing religious liberty issues. And, you know, that's one of my serious concerns, you know, that in our nation, especially in light of the Equality Act. Those listeners that may have not heard about the Equality Act, it was passed in the House of Representatives, and it's a direct assault upon religious liberty for people of faith, specifically Christians and Jewish businesses. When you think of the cake baker, the florist, the Christian counselor, these are very disturbing times, Phil, about what's going on with the Democratic Party. It seems to be more so a party of hypocrisy.
Well, and believe me, Dr. Harper, here in California, we are all too aware of the degree to which government is trying to prevent people of faith from acting upon their moral conscience.
Yes.
This is an issue that is front and center here in California. And sadly, as you point out, it's becoming a national one. And Democrats are doing their best to make California policy a national policy, I think.
Yes. Very alarming. And my hope is, and many evangelical Christians, is that the Senate would definitely kill the Equality Act from progressing there. We have a lot at stake in this next election, of course, for President Trump and members of the Congress. Hopefully, the Senate will stay in control of the Republicans and get back the House of Representatives because of this assault on religious freedom. And I do know that there are some Democrats that would not support the attack on people of faith and the businesses, but they're in the minority. And very, like I said, alarming that in this trend of an assault on our freedoms, and something has to be done.
I'm curious. I'll tell you what, we've got to get to a break here. Can you stick around for one more segment?
Sure.
I would appreciate that. Our guest is Dr. Anthony Harper. He is the White House correspondent for Intermountain Christian News and Christian Newspaper Association. We will talk more about his experiences in the White House press room right after this on the Phil Cowan program, 7:15. Our guest this half hour is Dr. Anthony Harper, White House correspondent with Intermountain Christian News and Christian Newspaper Association. What I wanted to ask you, Dr. Harper, you said that you are one of just a handful, I guess, of reporters in the White House press room from Christian news sources. Are those Christian reporters currently covering the White House, are they by and large conservative? Are there any of them that, because I mean, there is a strain of Christian faith right now that is leaning pretty far left. I'm not sure I quite understand it, but it happens. Are there any of those in there?
Oh, I believe so. This is a real minority issue of presence of the Christian media there, and I don't see any I don't see very very many actually of the Christian media there, but I have run into a couple of the media. I can't name those news sources at this point, but I do have a concern about the left leaning even of some so-called Christian media. But it is a very disturbing what was going on in there, and I know a lot of people with evangelical Christian churches of our readership would like to see more of Christian media presence there, and I think this interview with President Trump here, hopefully in the very near future, would go a long way.
And please do let us know if that happens, and I hope that it does, when it will be available on podcast, because I'd love to let our listeners know. It'd be fascinating to watch an interview with a conservative Christian journalist. That's something that we've not seen from any president that I can recall.
Yes, I have the responsibility. I'm asking some questions that can make several people uncomfortable. And I'm dealing with religious liberty issues, dealing with the Equality Act, about the hypocrisy of the Democratic Party, it seems like, and attacking people of faith. And
and you mentioned questions that you might ask about Israel. Is it your observation that most of the folks in that room, when they ask questions about Israel, they frame it from the perspective that Israel is in the wrong and oppressive?
Yes, I want to make it very clear. A lot of people really don't understand, I think, history on this matter. The term Palestine or Palestinian was a derogatory term that the Roman Caesar gave. Caesar named that land Palestine. This was Israel before. So, you know, a lot of the press, a lot of people refer to Israel as the occupier, but historically, it's really the non-Jewish population being the occupier in this case. And a lot of evangelical Christians would like to see that change, that narrative, you know, for people to really understand history. And we hear a lot about the Palestinians, the Palestinian people. But since Palestine does not exist anymore, then are there truly any Palestinian people? When you think of a people, they would have to have a unique language, which they don't have. There's no Palestinian language. It's Arab, and no specific Palestinian culture.
And the truth is, there has never been a sovereign state called Palestine, has there?
There never has. Like you said, you know, the Roman Caesar named this, and this was, you know, actually Rome was occupying this land. Historically, this has been Israel for a long time, and so I think there really needs to be a real education improvement to understand about what really has gone on there in light of the Roman Caesars. And so I know the Roman Caesar didn't think very highly of the Jewish people. It's a derogatory term, renaming their cities. I see that that false narrative playing out in a lot of the press referring to Israel's occupier. And what was brought up here recently was, you know, this administration acknowledgement of Israel's sovereignty in the West Bank, these settlements. That's a really big deal. I think also in light of President Trump announcing Israel's sovereignty over the Golan Heights. My question to President Trump would be, what about Israel's sovereignty over Judea and Samaria? As is a huge question, a lot of evangelical Christians and Orthodox Jews see the importance of asking that question of President Trump to honor their sovereignty over those areas, basically the heartland of Israel.
Before we run out of time here, I wanted to address this issue of what has come to be known as fake news, as the president has taken to calling it, and in no uncertain terms and in very public settings. In your observation, in watching the way the press has treated this administration, I think we all can admit they're hostile. They don't agree with this administration or its policies. They don't like President Donald J. Trump. But do you believe, Dr. Anthony Harper, have they been honest in their reporting?
Not at all. I mean, I see misquoting of so-called facts, the fixation on one narrative, and that is hate of President Trump and not accepting him as a president. Fake news, I would say in general, doesn't support our Judeo-Christian values. Often I see the fake news sources, mainstream media, supporting candidates that oppose our Judeo-Christian values. And so I think foundationally issue is truth and perspective and motive for their reporting, leaving out very important facts. I would say that if you leave out very important facts, it becomes a lie. And we see that our serious concern in the Democratic Party, leaving out very crucial facts and lying, and yet accusing President Trump and a lot of other people of wrongdoing here. And it's very disturbing that about this hypocrisy. But we have so serious challenges and issues to deal with regarding this issue of fake news. And I had an interview with Andrew Klavan of Prager University.
I am a big fan. I think one of the things I like about Andrew Klavan, not only is he a clear thinker and a wonderful writer, he can be wickedly funny.
Oh, very funny. And so I'd encourage people to watch that video that he has titled Fake News. And I think what could be done about this, I know President Trump is concerned about this so often, is, you know, to get Christian media there, get some good media people there and call upon them more. President Trump doesn't have to call upon mainstream media in these press meetings, and I think that would be so encouraging for a lot of evangelical Christians and Orthodox Jews, and I know of our readership, to see more representation there. There is a conservative Jewish news presence there. It's called Ami Magazine. I know the reporter for that. His name is Jake Church. There are some conservative news sources there. I know the White House correspondent for Fox News, Kevin Cork. And thankfully, Phil, we have some good people there, but we'll hopefully get a lot more.
Yeah, that would be encouraging. One more question before you go. The couple of times that this administration has pushed back against Jim Acosta and the gentleman from Playboy magazine, whose name I cannot recall, and I think there was yet another reporter who had their press passes briefly revoked. Did any of those, as a journalist, did they bother you or strike you as wrong?
Well, they're coming from a different worldview and reporting, and I don't see CNN being a news source based in truth, nor do I see Playboy magazine as well as based in truth and the facts of the matter. But I'm friendly with them, you know, we just have a little, we definitely, because of this worldview, we report from a totally different perspective. I've been with Jim Acosta. I'm familiar with what he went through and his press credentials. And the Playboy reporter, his first name is Brian. I believe you pronounce his last name Karim or Kareem or something like that. But, I watched that interchange of Jim Acosta with President Trump in a press meeting. I watched Brian's interchange with Dr. Sebastian Gorka in the Rose Garden. And it's quite some unique opportunities visiting with these people. I continue to try to be a good influence as much as I can with them.
Yeah, did you ever witness that level of aggression on the part of any member of the White House press contingent in the previous administration?
Never.
Yeah.
So the interchange is so intense. You cut the emotions with a knife in there. It is so troubling with this hostility, and I would like to see that change. I would like to see this enforceable code of ethics, and I'm thankful that you know about Andrew Klavan. Dennis Prager has been in the news a lot about concern about, I think, in the matter of YouTube and censorship. The Prager University has a lot of good to offer. I really enjoyed their resources.
They've done wonderful work. And as I said, I read Andrew Klavan regularly over at PJ Media, and I think he's just, shame on me, I have yet to read one of his novels. I understand they're good.
Well, I'm sure that they are, and there's so much to read, and we can be very thankful. We have some good resources, but my hope and prayer is that we'll have a lot more good media there, and we'll see this change as far as the prevalence of getting having good media people being called upon more, overlooking the mainstream media that doesn't seem to reflect very well our Judeo-Christian values and our readership, and
Or even good, honest journalism, for that matter.
Good, honest journalism. And we don't see enough of that. And I think it was made very clear in my interview with President's Deputy Press Secretary, Hogan Gidley, that there is not truly objective journalism, but that it's more opinion-oriented.
Yeah, it certainly feels that way. Well, we are out of time here. Dr. Harper, it's a pleasure to have you on. Please keep up the good work, and let's stay in touch. I would love to know if and when this this podcast interview with the president happens, because I'd love to direct our listeners there.
Well, thank you. It's great to join you, Phil.
It's a pleasure to have you. Thanks very much. I appreciate you taking the time. 7:31 a.m., 1380, The Answer, here on the Phil Cowan Program.